relatively tame one by many standards, but nonetheless extremely safe. And they're just demonstrating just how little runway. That's followed by the AOP-9. The Bell 47 Sioux helicopter run very much, as you know, essentially an American machine made famous by the Korean War and many other television series. The start of fixed wing very much involved in the reconnaissance business. It was all about looking over the hill and getting one over on your enemy. The earliest you could get of recognizing where the enemy were, the sooner you had the opportunity to stop them advancing and stop them taking advantage of the friendly forces. And literally within years of the Orville Wright and his brother getting airborne across in North America, the British Army had already established its foothold in aviation through the establishment at the end of the late 19th century with its balloon flights. And it was the Royal Engineers we have to thank for that. And a certain engineer, Lieutenant Colonel Capper, happened to befriend the Mahoney machine in 1908 with the advance into full-time military aviation. And that spurned what, to a certain extent, you see today. This is merely a snapshot of aviation history from the Army, featuring very much the mid-50s through to around about the mid-80s, with the Bell 47 at the front end and the Beaver very much lasting on into operations in Northern Ireland on Operation Banner right up until the end of the 80s. All have their own utility. Pretty much all the helicopters have been armed in one way or another. Even this Sioux helicopter in front of you now had a GPMG mounted on the skids there, where generally speaking you would normally have seen a casualty in a stretcher. This aircraft piloted today by so much, it's very similar to all our pilots, an ex-Army Air Corps operational pilot, Rich Billens, currently now engaged with Boeing full-time on testing aircraft, and our chief pilot, demonstrating the maneuverability of this particular machine. The visibility, obviously outstanding, but it was very slow, and also into a tall turn now. He'll fill the carrot centre for the next minute or so in the absence of the Westland Scout. And you can see a very, very good aircraft in terms of certainly reconnaissance, but it couldn't be protected and it couldn't be. The American Army Air Corps saw its potential as a massive utility aircraft, and it was quickly followed by the British Army as well. He bought 44 of these machines in the early 60s. This particular aircraft is 60 years old this year, and I have to say it's certainly one of my favourites, and those who know me out there will know that I spent an awful lot of time around the world flying the Beaver in all sorts of various observation and reconnaissance roles, but also on skis and floats as well. It is an incredibly flexible and adaptable machine, but it was loaded with all sorts of additional electronic equipment during the latter days of the 80s in the counter-terrorism role. Playing in those days, that actually what they needed was aircraft in the air to do this job of not just identifying the enemy, but of course then neutralizing them at the same time. And without that exercise having taken place, it is quite possible that the entire history of British aviation may not have literally taken off at the time, just a couple of years before the start of the First World War. Bertram Dixon luckily had two observers with him that day, a young Winston Churchill and Lord Kitchener. And they were immediately convinced once Bertram had landed his aircraft. I mean, he, a pioneer, a Royal Artillery man, he nipped across to France to get his pilot's license as soon as possible to convince the powers that be that they needed to invest in this, and thus was born the Royal Flying Corps. It is an extraordinary story and one that will live on in terms of the early development. And aircraft and aviation and air crews at Duxford, a real privilege and a pleasure just to bring a few of these aircraft to you here today. Going now by in slow formation here, you see the Beaver back to about 65 knots. It's got a huge flap opportunity there. You can drop up to 58 degrees, a massive barn door of flap, braking now for their final maneuver. As would be becoming, of course, any Army officer whilst in charge of a flying machine. And the story continues, of course, because very soon around these parts of the neighborhood, you will see the E-model Apache, now one of the most complex and outstanding and capable rotorcraft machines of the modern era. But of course, essentially, whilst it has all that help, it has the digital hardware, it has the weapons on board, it has the radar,
was a private pilot, in fact, alongside being an artillery officer, who had a little aerobic bathtub in the 1930s, with which he saw the opportunities, didn't he, for using a light aircraft like that for over-the-horizon artillery spotting.
Yeah. And surely, guys, when you see, when you look at the Mark 1 in particular in our hangar,
yes,
there's absolutely nothing on it.
Yes,
you know,
it's very
guys,
basic.
These guys deployed to northern France, particularly around D-Day, and they did a sterling job, and I take my hats off to them, because today it is just so much easier.
Yeah.
And of course, there was no defence. I mean, at least the Spitfires and Hurricanes had some weapons on board,
yes,
to scare the enemy, even if they didn't hit them.
Yes.
But these guys had absolutely nothing. So I'm going back to the stand. I'll be there for another hour or so at the tail end towards the American Museum.